الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله محمد وعلى آله وصحابه أجمعين أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون وقال تعالى إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء وقال تعالى قل هل يستوي الذين يعلمون والذين لا يعلمون. So my dear brothers and sisters, before I start, just to remind myself and you that the basic purpose for which Allah has created us and sent to this earth is to worship Him, ibadah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created the people, the mankind, to worship Him. And then He has given them space, this earth, which can help them how to worship Him. Because when He created us, we need to eat, we need to drink, we need houses, we need things. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, He gave us all those things and then He commanded us to worship Him. What happens is when the people are on the earth, they become more interested because the world is so interesting. So, you know, people start enjoying it, you know, eating, drinking, enjoyment and all those things. So they forget their purpose. The purpose to worship Him alone, they forget the purpose. That's why the messengers keep coming to remind. So anyway, when the people forget the purpose of the creation, so they become more and more interested in this world. And they actually, you know, and they also, you know, learn and teach, but their focus becomes more those things which are concerned to this world. So, you know, there are so many sciences which basically more are around the space. So there are two types of the knowledge. The knowledge which teaches you how to worship your Lord and how to use the space according to His command. Second type of the knowledge is where actually how to use this space and to make it more enjoyable and more beneficial for you without knowing the purpose. So this always keep happening. The messengers came to teach you the first one, how to worship your Lord and also how to use the space properly. You know, how to eat, how to drink, how to earn money, halal and haram. So, you know, the messengers and prophets don't stop you from earning money. They don't stop you from eating and drinking. They don't stop from marriage. No, they teach you but right manner. So this, I've seen really, you know, I was once, you know, last week, I was passing by, you know, a group of the students, they are in the University of Oxford, and one of them is spitting in front of him. So, you know, the basic thing, how to spit, people don't learn. You know, the people learn about the machines. Every single knowledge that we learn, how to improve the machinery, the machines, everything else. But people don't learn, actually, how to improve themselves. You know, no doubt in the whole creation, the mankind is the most important. So, if you learn anything, the first thing to learn, actually, is how I can make myself more important. How can I make myself to my Lord is, you know, loves me, the angels love us. So that's what the prophet and messenger come. They teach you the right manner. They teach you how to worship your Lord and also how to behave properly with the other human being and also how to, you know, not to be greedy, not to deceiving, not to cheating, you know, and be content, be generous, you know, those qualities which can make you better. So that is why it is very, very important to get the knowledge for which the messengers and the prophets came. And no doubt the last among them is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the knowledge that he gave to the people, they are contained in two forms. One is the Quran, most important one. And the second one is Sunnah, which is contained in the books of the Hadith. So learning them, you know, this thing actually, it has so much reward. You know, because you learn, you act upon that and also you teach people. So when you are learning the Hadith, about the Hadith, you get reward for that. Any money that you spend, you get reward for that. And when you teach people, you get reward for that. To understand this properly, any money that you spend here, it is not wasted. You get so much reward. Any effort that you make, you get up early morning in the weekend, people want to have rest. But you come there, make effort, you know, you get reward for that. This is very important to understand. This knowledge basically is, you know, to how to make you a better human being in the eye of your Lord and in the eye of the people. The people can see how the human being, you know, live. So in a sense, the simple of the whole matter is that the most important knowledge is to learn the ibadah, and then secondary to that is to learn those things which can help you for the ibadah, like eating, drinking, earning money. But even those things which help you for ibadah, they must be done according to the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then they also become ibadah. So when people learn medicine or something like that, if the purpose is, you know, to worship, then even that, they get so much reward. When we come to ibadah, as I mentioned, ibadah never can be done with the mind. People don't know how to do ibadah. Ibadah always must be coming from teachings of a messenger. In Islam, nothing can be ibadah unless it is coming from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from the Quran and from the Sunnah. So the Quran, as we know, we have got, but the Sunnah, these people. And really, the how much effort they have made, amazing thing really. There's Sahaba, then Tabi'een, Sa'id Musayyab, you know, Urwa ibn Zubair, Qasim ibn Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr as-Siddiq, Alqama and Aswad, then Ibrahim Naqai, Hassan al-Basri, Muhammad ibn Sirin, amazing people. Then after that, next generation of the people like Malik, Sufyan al-Thawri, Abu Hanifa, Awza'i, Layth ibn Sa'ad, and then the next generation, you know, Shafi'i, people like him, and then after that come Ahmad al-Hanbal, in all the generation. You know, so much effort and the sacrifices they have done, you know, it really one cannot believe. You know, very often, you know, they sacrifice their, you know, many of these people, they could have become very, very rich people. They sacrifice their richness, their money, and they're so clever for the sake of Islam. And really, you know, the effort they have made. And they're not superficial like us. When we learn little bit from here and there. These people spend their time. And I can say, when you read the biographies of these people, you really can see they are great thinkers, they're professional, they do things properly. For example, now we go to read Trimidhi. Amazing work, really. So much nicely done. You know, you hardly can find really fault, and how hardly you can see, you know, it would have been better if he had done this way. You know, in our time, when people even write an essay, you can see there's some effort and something is missing, so many problems. But these people, they spend their life to collect the data from here and there, discuss properly, and then at the end, late of their life, then they collect those information properly, put together with argument and a thesis, and you know, and as much effort as possible, that they teach them. So when they teach, if there is any problem, because when they teach, they should not discuss with them. So they keep improving until they die. Really, this is a thing. And when they say something, it is very difficult really to differ from them. And when the people differ from them without proper knowledge, you can see the problem. And in our time, actually, I have seen many, many people, you know, especially Imam Tirmidhi, when the people differ from Imam Tirmidhi, I hardly find anybody, when they differ, they are right. Because these people, when they're writing, they are not writing from tahdhib al-tahdhib al-taqrib al-tahdhib. These information they used to discuss in the classroom. So when Tirmidhi comes to learn from his teachers, before coming, he had already studied his hadith somewhere else. He knows what are good hadith of this teacher, what are problem. Then they come to learn. And they discuss with the teacher. And when the teacher has left the classroom, they discuss with other students. So all the problems of the hadith of every single teacher, they know. So they will know, for example, this hadith of Waqim ibn Jarrah from Sufyan Thawri has problem. So how many hadith Sufyan Thawri, Waqim narrates from Sufyan Thawri, and how many they are right, and how many mistakes are there, and who is better than Waqi in those hadith, you know, they already know. So this actually how they used to do, and most of the knowledge used to be in mind. Maybe not in details, but they know. So when they put together, they easily can refer to their notes because they know what actually problem is there. We don't know the problem. You know, for example, I teach Sahih Bukhari, to, you know, whenever sometimes Bukhari says, Taba'ahu fulanun, so and so support, so and so. He does not say everywhere. But when he says so and so supported, so and so, most time in the commentaries, you don't find why Bukhari says this. When he said, think really, he does not say everywhere, so when he says somewhere, there must be a problem. He wants to solve the problem. If you don't know the problem, you cannot know how he's solving. And alhamdulillah, you are making effort actually going back. Similarly, I'm writing commentary on Sahih Muslim. I really can see how much knowledge there is really. Even his arrangement, when he brings a hadith in a chapter, and which one start first, then second, third, there is so much knowledge, so much discussion behind it. And also every chapter after the other chapter, one chapter, the second chapter, how he moved, you know, there's so much thinking. It is not simple arrangement. It is very, very complicated, very difficult, you know, arrangement. So similarly, Imam Tirmidhi, rahimahullah ta'ala, because before him, you can see, Imam Tirmidhi spent a lot of time with Bukhari, studying with him. People in our time will think really, once Bukhari, Sahih Bukhari is there, then we cannot play any role in Islam after Sahih Bukhari. But these people, they really find, no, there are so much we can do. The Imam Tirmidhi, he knows Sahih Bukhari, he knows Sahih Muslim, he knows Sunan of Abu Dawud. At least these three sources, he knows well. And you can find signs of that in his book. Actually, he refers to them. He knows these three, still he feels needs to write a fourth one, something different. And he can feel he can make contribution. And it can not only a contribution just for the sake of contribution, you can see really there's so much knowledge there. This is how they used to think. Great thinkers, and also from very beginning to the end, you know, consistent. It could be that Tirmidhi is not like Bukhari, so his conditions are not the same. But whatever conditions he has made, he is consistent from beginning to the end. So one of the good quality of these people is they're very, very consistent. They know and they're consistent. For example, people like me, if I write a book, so sometimes you can see I'm so nice, so excellent. But other time, you know, something I say it is silly. Reason is because I don't make full effort for every single thing. These people, for every single hadith, they have spent so much time. They discuss with the people problems. And you can see Imam Tirmidhi especially, he discusses, you know, all these hadiths with Bukhari, with Abu Zura al-Razi, with Imam Darimi, and all the experts of his time. He discusses with them and he keeps coming back to those discussions.